So this video is part two in a little video series I'm doing all about the question I get a lot, am I teaching math right? I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today we're going to delve into the content emphases in order to help us answer that question, am I teaching math right? Now, if you missed it, part one of this video series was all about trying to figure out, should we be teaching math conceptually or should we be teaching math procedurally? So if you missed that, click the link down below this video to find out. Okay, so let's first start off with, what are the content emphases? The content emphases, some of you may know them as the major work. When Common Core State Standards came out, it was just a list of standards. Now, whether or not you use the Common Core State Standards or not, I'm going to use a document that is geared towards the Common Core State Standards, but the idea is something that you should be doing no matter what standards you are using. So these content emphases documents were put out to help us really understand which standards play a larger role in helping to develop our students' understanding. Because let's face it, not all the standards carry the same weight. Not all of them should be getting basically the same play time inside of your classroom, right? Each standard is, it's not just a list of things to go through and make sure that you cover. Instead, there are certain ones that we should really be taking time to delve deep into. So these content emphases documents are broken down into the clusters of standards, and each one is highlighted with a certain color. So I'll pull up the document here, and you can see how there are green ones, there are blue, and there are yellow. So I want you to take a look at those, and in this document, I'll link to it down below here, but the document has kindergarten through eighth grade. So this one is showing kindergarten. And as you can see, the next to each cluster, there's either a green rectangle, a yellow circle, or the blue outline of a rectangle. The green ones dictate the major clusters. These are the things that are the huge, really big deals at that grade level. And then the yellow ones are the ones that are kind of additional. Like these are, they're not the things that, oh, hey, you know, these aren't really important, but they're the things that, you know, if we, in an ideal world, let's be honest, we would love to get through everything, but that doesn't really happen. So the yellow ones are things that aren't really tied to other things, and we have to find a way to bring them in another area. Because the blue ones on here are ones that tie to the green ones. They're known as supporting standards. So they aren't standalone big ideas, but they are mathematical concepts that will help our children understand that major work even better. Okay, so let's take a look at one of these grade levels here. Let's pull up fifth grade here so we get another view of one. And if we're looking at the blue, I'm looking at 5.md.a. And it says, convert like measurement units within a given measurement system. So that is not necessarily a skill in and of itself that we need to teach to kids. Instead, it is a way, it is a mathematical concept, this idea of converting measurements that we can use to help our kids better understand some of the green clusters up there. Could we use converting like measurements to help our kids be able to perform operations with multi-digit whole numbers and with decimals to the hundreds? You bet. Could we use conversions to help our kids better understand our place value system? You bet, right? So those blue ones are things that we should be doing to help support the green ones. They aren't standalone standards. And so that's what's been difficult with our standards, is everything's just kind of in this big list. And number one, we don't know which ones play a bigger role. And number two, we don't know what order to teach them in. That information is coming up in our last video, so stay tuned for part three. But right now we're going to build on that idea of which ones should we really be focusing on. And that's what this document really helps us do. It's through achievethecore.org. And when they first put them out, they were known as the content emphases. Like, what are the things that should be emphasized at certain grade levels? Now, one of the things I want to draw your attention to is there's a very, very tiny print line at the bottom that talks about the percentage of time in the classroom that we should be spending on this major work. And it's a little eye-opening. So let me zoom in on that. It says that at least 65 and up to approximately 85% of class time should be devoted to the major work of your grade level. That is huge. Now, I'm not going to do this for you, but if you want to calculate how many days of school you have and be honest with yourself about how many actual teaching days you have, okay? That's not, you get interrupted for assemblies. The first few days before holiday breaks are pretty much a wash, right? All of those kinds of things that come into play of when you're not really kind of focused on a lesson per day during that time. Be honest of how many days we spend teaching math, and then break it down into how many days you actually have to teach the blue and the yellow stuff, and how many days should be devoted to those green clusters. And I bet you might be wanting to reflect a little bit about how much time you have spent on the other things. Now, here's the deal. These documents can seem a little overwhelming when you start looking at those numbers, but I want you to really reflect, okay? Because I know you're already strapped for time. Your textbook has more than you can teach already, and you're trying to do the best you can with the information you have. And so this video series, I'm not wanting you to be able to watch this and think, oh, I'm not doing it right. It's to have you reflect and be like, okay, where am I right now? And what can I do to make it a little bit better, and then a little bit better? As we learn more, we just get better and better and better at our teaching, right? We don't do it right the first time. None of us do. So use this information in a way that makes you feel like, okay, I'm doing just a little bit better here and a little bit better here. So what I'm asking you to really do is reflect upon whether or not you're going deep enough into those green standards. Those are really the key pieces here. Okay, I'm going to stop for a moment. I'm going to play a little clip of Phil Darrow talking about this whole idea of breadth, like the width or breadth, however you want to call it, versus the depth. Okay, and why it's so important that we really focus on going deep for our kids and not just trying to cover it all.
So mile wide, inch deep, we didn't want to be part of that problem. So we tried to our goal is to attain focus and coherence. The Singapore website's banner says, teach less, learn more. The results, the only one we have for this are fourth grade that I know about. In the TIMSS, the international comparison, the test has more than any country teaches, because they wanted to, if kids learn stuff, they wanted the kids to get credit, the nation to get credit. Singapore taught 45% of the topics on the TIMSS test, less than half. They were the number one performing, Hong Kong. Now, this is Hong Kong. The U.S. taught 80% of the topics. They were among the lowest performing. So covering does not translate into test performance. The Hong Kong students got more depth on less topics and did better on this test than the U.S. students, who got superficial knowledge. And we know in mathematics that it's not until your understanding reaches a certain depth, which is deeper than we teach to, that it transfers. And it drives us crazy as teachers. They learn it in this context. Next day you give them a different context, it's like they didn't learn a thing. That means their learning was superficial. I mean, transfer is a task. I'm not pretending it's not. If they can get deeper, it transfers more readily.
Now, I have to say, I really hate it when I see international comparisons, but that's the world we live in, okay? We are being compared to other countries and how they perform no matter what. It's a thing that we have to deal with. However, the piece that I hope you really take away from that is that we can't teach it all. And when we try to teach it all we're doing is giving just that surface view of the mathematics, and kids aren't really getting a true understanding of the math in a way that allows them to apply it. You don't have the time to teach everything to your students and in every possible way that they might see it on a test. We have to teach a concept deeply so that no matter how they see it, how it's presented to them, they have a true understanding of the concept and can make sense no matter how it's presented. So I want you to really use this document to help you remember what is truly important. What is it that if my students leave with nothing else this year except for this, then that's great. And hopefully it's not just this one thing, right? But there are a few things at each grade level that kids should really, really go deep into. What is that? Have that conversation. And the last thing I really want to end with and leave you with is how to use this document. Don't keep it to yourself. This is not just for you and your grade level. The most powerful way I've seen this used, and the way I've used it in PD with schools I work with, is doing it throughout all the grade levels. I've done it K-5, I've done it K-12 with districts, where we look at what is truly, truly important at each grade level, and we say, these are the things this grade level is kind of responsible for. And I know it's every group of kids is different, so I hate using that, you're responsible for this terminology, but these are the big things at this grade level that we're trying to get them to understand. And then this grade level's doing these pieces. And it's helpful when you have that conversation out loud with the whole span of grades to say, this is what's happening at this grade level and this grade level and this grade level. It allows a little bit more freedom because this is what's really important. And the grade above me knows this is what we're really focusing on in my grade level. And the grade below me knows this is my focus. And we talk about ways to be able to help each other out. All too often, it's always been seen as like, this is the third grade stuff and the fourth grade stuff and the fifth grade stuff, right? And I'm going to use a non-math example here. But if you're a fifth grade teacher and you have to get kids ready for the science test, right, that happens at fifth grade, if you're the only teacher doing science and getting them ready for that, that's a heavy weight to bear. And so we have to view this as a long distance run. This teaching kids mathematics is a long distance marathon. It is not just for the short term, what do I need my kids to know at the end of second grade? It's thinking long term about everything that they're going to be learning through their mathematical journey and how it all fits together. And sometimes we have to be okay letting things go so that we can focus on the pieces that really matter. And I really love the quote that Phil Darrow talks about in that full video where he talks about in Singapore, their motto is teach less, learn more. We have to be able to really focus in on what's important, teach that deeply so that our kids can really understand more. The more that we give them time to go deep and learn about connections between things, the more that they will really understand about mathematics. So I hope that this document helps you out and helps your whole school out, your whole district out. Take it, use it, talk about it throughout all the grade levels, and really have a deep conversation about what's important through each grade level and be okay sometimes letting things go so that you can focus in, slow down, so you can focus on the things that are truly important. So I hope this helps you build your math mind so that you can go build those math minds of your students. Have a great day.